In this video, I'm going to be talking about some of the modern frameworks and formats for data serialization. I'm going to be covering slides from the University of Southern California, Viterbi, and a link is provided to those slides in the description of this video. So specifically, I'm going to be talking about Google's Protocol Buffers framework, Apache Thrift, and the Apache Avro projects, and when and why they're useful. So consider that you have a distributed system. Your application is built on a distributed architecture by which a client has to talk to a server, and these are on separate hosts, or they're at least separate processes. So in order to do this, your data has to be serialized as a message to go from client to server and the response back. So some of the things that you need to consider are, what kind of a protocol are you going to use to pass this data back and forth? And how can you do that efficiently? And what do you do with those requests on the server? So, over a number of years, people have been trying to tackle this problem. There are a number of implementations that have came and gone. For example, SOAP, CORBA, COM and DCOM, JSON, you could use plain text or XML. These all work for serializing your data and talking between servers. But it turns out none of them are ideal. So with SOAP, you just have tons of XML that you have to parse. It's really inefficient. CORBA, apparently just over-designed and heavyweight. And then DCOM, COM Plus, it's mainly Windows-specific, while the frameworks I'm going to be covering in this presentation are open-source projects that work cross-platform. And you could always just use HTTP, JSON, XML, plain text, but there are a number of problems with this too. For example, you don't have a protocol description anywhere, no schema to adhere to or anything. So you have to maintain both the client and server code. You have to make sure that the versions match and that the server expects the format of the request from the client, and the client expects the version of the response that the server is going to send. And if you use XML, again, it has high parsing overhead, and they're expensive to process because the tags are repeated over and over throughout the request. So, again, the three I'm going to cover are protocol buffers, Apache Thrift, and Avro. I'm going to compare these, and then I'm also going to talk about JSON a little bit, which is one of the options that you saw here. So, some of the common properties in all these serialization frameworks, they all have an interface description language, or an IDL. They all have high performance, they all have versioning, and they all support some sort of a binary format. So the first one I'll talk about is Google's Protocol Buffers, or Protobuf for short. It was designed in 2001 because there wasn't really a good option. I think those were in the days that CORBA was around, and I think SOAP may have been around back then. But Google kept this, they used it all over production, and continue to, ever since 2001. And in 2008, they open-sourced it. It's battle-tested, especially by Google. It's very stable and well-trusted. And every time you use any of the Google services, you're using Protobuf, whether you know it or not. You know, their servers are communicating with each other using this exact protocol. It's the glue to all their services, and it's supported officially in C++, Java, Python, and JavaScript. And there's third-party support, and some of the libraries are good, some not so good. And it's BSD licensed. Apache Thrift is another option. It was designed by an ex-Googler in 2007. That was before Protobuf was open sourced. This ex-Googler worked at Facebook, and that's where it was developed. Right now it's an Apache incubator project, and it aimed to be the next generation of protocol buffers. They added some more features to it and improved the syntax slightly. They also support a larger number of programming languages, officially. And they also offer an implementation of a remote procedure call stack. So you describe the data, and it'll automatically generate for you the code that you would need for an RPC. So, the way that both of these work is, in the IDL, you write down these struct-like message formats. And then you run a tool to generate whatever boilerplate code from that from that schema or from that interface definition. And it'll generate the code for you to use in whichever programming language you require. The output's mainly human-readable, and you link against that output when you build your application. These files are not meant to be edited manually. So here's a depiction of what that process looks like. You would write your IDL, you define the data types and the service interfaces, then you run the code generation tool, and that'll output a number of different clients or servers that can bind to the generated code based on your data structures. And then you basically run your client or server application, and you're good to go. So, about IDLs, it describes software components interface. They are defined in a language-independent way, and it lets you talk across an application that's implemented with services that are written in different programming languages. So they're very common in remote procedure call software. You're invoking a procedure or a method on a remote server. And the nice thing about this is that the programming language you're using on the client and server can be different. It really doesn't matter. So here's an example of the IDLs between Thrift and Protobuf. Each of these fields has a number here. I'll explain that later, but it has to do with the versioning of the data structures that are generated. So we have a number of different structs in here, and in this case, enumerations, some nesting within the types. This one supports some of the richer data structure types. You have typed lists here, and you can have maps, etc. in Thrift, and more on that later. So, again, every field must have a unique positive integer identifier, and that's used for versioning. They can be required or optional, and you specify that in the IDL. They can contain other structs and messages. That's the nesting that you saw on the previous slide. And you can specify an optional default value. So here's an example of a Protobuf IDL on the left, and the corresponding Java code that's generated for you, or the way that you would interact with those generated classes from your Protobuf IDL. This line here belongs on the right hand side, and I'm sure that's pretty clear. They've defined a person here with a name, ID, email. They have a phone type enumeration, and then a phone number, or a list of phone numbers. In Protobuf, you use this repeated keyword here to say that it's a list. On the right-hand side, you see that it's automatically generated for you a builder class here that just lets you chain these setter methods and then call .build, and that would return a person object for you. So here's a comparison of the two, a feature comparison. You see that the base types are pretty similar. There are a few missing here and there. For example, Protobuf supports raw byte sequences when Thrift addresses that just as strings or individual bytes, or you could use a list of bytes, and you'll see that in the next section. Because Thrift has containers, for example, you can have an ordered list of elements, you can have sets, maps, and in Protobuf you don't have any of these. Both of them support enumerations, and only Thrift supports constants that you can declare in your IDLs. Thrift also supports exceptions, while Protobuf does not. So you can see this comparison. Both compilers are written in C++. The license for Thrift is Apache, and BSD for Protobuf. They're both similar licenses, very, very liberal licenses. The RPC Thrift includes the RPC implementation, which will generate server-side code for you, and as well as client-side code, so you can invoke a remote procedure on the other server. Protobuf does not have one in their framework, though it's reported that Google does use one internally. and Protobuf has composite type extensions, and they're both versioned. So this shows the differences in size of the serialized data. In this case, it's a course object with 5 person objects and 1 phone object. You see that protocol buffers actually becomes, it serializes to the smallest size. And that's when, I'll get to this later, but optimize 4 is one of the options when you're compiling the code. You can optimize it for speed or size. But Thrift actually offers a number of different protocols here. You see that the plain binary protocol, it's faster to process than the compact protocol, but it's more difficult to debug, and it's a larger size as well. The compact protocol is optimized for space efficiency, and this shows a number of the other implementations for serialization formats. You can use Java's RMI, and that was actually the largest size. Then you also have JSON and XML. So versioning is an important one because in client-server applications, certain services may be updated, and you want the interdependent services to be able to communicate with each other despite the versions. You want the server to be able to accept outdated clients, and you want the newer clients to be able to talk to a slightly outdated server, etc. So it's implemented via those field identifiers, those positive integers that we saw earlier, and as well as its type. It's the combination of those two. You don't have to recompile the code that's using those. For example, that builder is still going to include those same messages because the older versions of those fields are still there in the IDL. You are only going to add fields to that. That way the client and server can support backwards compatibility. Now, on the other hand, something like CORBA or RMI, that would require you to update all the clients if you were to update the server code. All the clients would need to be updated as well in order to even talk to the server. So Thrift is it's a pretty popular framework. It's used at a number of different big companies and also in some high-profile open-source projects. It's used all over Facebook. It's used in Cassandra. Hadoop offers an API to the HDFS, the distributed file system, and it's through Thrift bindings. And you see the rest of the list here. And a number of projects also use Protobuf. It's all over Google, and ActiveMQ, Netty, and probably a number of other high-profile projects and companies use it. They're just not included in this list. So a number of high-level pros and cons of both. With Thrift, I suppose the biggest thing would be that it has more languages supported out of the box. Google offers only support for 4 languages officially, and there are a number of other third-party libraries, but as we saw earlier, some of those are reported to be not so good. Also, you have the richer data structures. That's the list, set, and map types that Thrift has, and Protocol Buffers does not. And then also Thrift generates for you the RPC implementations. So Protocol Buffers, it's slightly faster than Thrift when you optimize for speed, and the serialized objects are slightly smaller than Thrift, and it has because it has more aggressive compression, better documentation, and the API is a bit cleaner than Thrift. So the third one that I haven't talked about till now is called Avro, and it deserves to be mentioned separate from those because it does things in a slightly different way. It has a number of options for when you serialize. You can serialize to binary, or you can serialize to JSON. And I'll get to more details about JSON here in a minute. But an interesting thing about Avro is that it supports reading and writing from Protobuf and Thrift. So this also has a fairly extensive number of languages that are supported. And it has rich data structures. key thing about this is that the schema is always available with that data. It basically passes a header file of the schema of that data, and that goes with the data, and that actually helps to bring down the overall message size as well, because you don't need those field identifiers. The schema is a header level message that goes across, and it precedes the binary data across the wire. It does include an RPC framework as well, and the other nice thing is that you don't actually have to compile from the IDL. So the other nice thing is that it integrates really well with dynamic languages. It has a generic type with it, and unlike the other frameworks, the schema is not presented at runtime. Another nice thing that can be very convenient depending on your application is that it can integrate very well with Hadoop MapReduce. The messages are they're compressible and splittable for your MapReduce jobs. So I want to take a moment here to talk about JSON. It happens that the Avro IDL syntax is implemented in JSON, and I want to take this opportunity to describe this to anyone who might not be familiar with this syntax. It stands for JavaScript Object Notation. It's a subset of the syntax used to define object literals in the JavaScript programming language. Focus here only on the part that's in red, between the opening and closing curly brace, which defines a JavaScript object. It's essentially a list of key value pairs, and the keys are always strings in JSON, and the values can be either strings, numbers, and you don't need quotes for those. They can be other objects, nested objects, or they can be arrays. So it's pretty simple, and it turns out that it's used as the syntax for the Avro IDL. So you see we have this fields array here, and this is similar to this essentially defines one struct in your IDL with the number of fields here, user ID, amount, and date stamp for a bank deposit message. This is the equivalent Thrift IDL. So we see it's a little more verbose, a little more syntax to it, but depending on your familiarity with JSON, you might feel more at home using this syntax. So here's a comparison with both Thrift and protocol buffers versus Avro. Avro has a dynamic schema. It's built into Hadoop. The schema is in JSON, and that's familiar to a lot of developers. You do not need to compile these Avro IDLs. You don't need field IDs in your IDL. It's bleeding edge, and it has a sexy name. So it provides a similar functionality, but it has dynamic typing. It doesn't require any code generation, and the data is always accompanied by a schema. The data is untagged because the schema is present with it, and less type information needs to be encoded with the data, and the overall serialization size is a lot smaller. It doesn't have any manually assigned field IDs, which can make things a lot less confusing when you're working with version systems. So with this, if you change the data, the new schema is present with it, so the differences can be resolved symbolically. You just refer to the field name instead of these integer IDs. So here are a number of performance metrics. I'm not going to go through these. It's a long list, but I'll let you go ahead and take a look. One thing to note is that the relative speed for total time is much lower for these binary formats as opposed to JSON, which can be used as a serialization format on its own. JSON is much, much, much slower than some of these other frameworks. A similar thing can be said for the size of the encoded message as well.